Name the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, one God. Amen. Lord, open my eyes so I see wonders of your law. Psalm 119. Welcome to a new episode of the whole Bible series where we study the Bible from the book of Genesis to Revelation. Today we're going to continue in chapter 2 in the book of Genesis, and we're going to check Darwin theory, and we're going to see what's the concept of Darwin theory and why we should reject it. So let's start. Genesis chapter 2, Adam versus Darwin. So this was the front page of Darwin's book, The Origin of Species, by Charles Darwin, London, 1859. So before we start to our today lecture, let's go over a review of Europe in the 1800s. It was a time of a change and rebellion. There was a lot of political turmoil, division of the Ottoman Empire and separation of states, wars and social instability, industrial revolution and rise of new generation who reject the old church doctrine, division within the Church of England and emergence of new movement like Puritan, Quaker, and Unitarians. The fact that helped Charles to form his theory, he was a motivated young man, no solid background in biology, special interest in bird, plant, and geology, early exposure to atheistic ideology, those people who deny the presence of God or the role of God in creation and believe animals and humans share the same mental trait. He was agnostic by definition. He realized the human brutality and dominance of the powerful early on in his trip. He had a lot of exposure to different countries, rich versus poor and land versus island, and that will make the distinction about the lack of food resources in history. The concept of evolution to Darwin. Basically, there are change of inheritable trait of biological organism over generation due to natural selection. A process is known as descent with modification. Over time, major change in species might happen, and they include formation of new species, changes within lineage, and loss of species or extinction. So emergence of new species and disappearance of some species. The surviving organism produce offspring who compete for natural resources. The fittest will survive and pass this trait on the offsprings. The environment will help certain organisms to live. That's called a natural selection. All organisms originate from one or few sources. This was Darwin's thought process, and he put down point A, B, C, and D, and he figured out that the creation was created in a similar way, and he can reach from point A to point B, and he put down his famous comment, I think. This was Darwin's tree of life. When you see the modern day species appear at the top of the chart, while the lower appear in the bottom of the chart. And you see here there are few resources as the origin of life, and the more complex and advanced creature are at the top of the chart. This is another map, a family tree of evolution after he studied birds in Galapagos Island, 1835. He made the comment that descent was modification, all creature coming from common ancestor, those on the left side are less developed, while those on the right side are the top of hierarchy of development. So let's go for some scientific word and their definition. Natural selection, it is a process by which organisms change over time as a result of a change in inheritable physical or behavioral trait. Change that allow an organism to better adapt to its environment and will help it survive and have more offspring. Microevolution, natural selection can change a species in a small way, causing a population to change color or size over the course of several generations. This is called microevolution. So a change within a species, minor changes like change of color, change of size, he called this microevolution. Actually, that was a wrong name. It's a misnomer. The true and accurate term is adaptation. Now we call this process adaptation, not microevolution. He went further by talking about macroevolution. In his own words, he said, but natural selection is also capable of much more. Given enough time, and enough accumulated changes, natural selection can create entirely new species. It can turn dinosaurs into birds, apes into human, amphibious animals into whales. And here's the example of North American blackbird have been transformed into the huge whales. And this is the famous cartoon diagram for the development of human. Start with ape, grew up a little bit and have little changes in the posture and shape until becoming a full human. So let's go over the basic component of Darwin's theory before we start to criticize it. Computation for limited natural resources. So he start by there is limited natural resources and there is a computation for these resources. Natural selection by the environment, a role for genetic mutation, gradual change over time, and here he mean millions of years. Some primitive species became extinct and were replaced by new species. Changes occur at micro and macro levels. Here comes the question, why do we reject Darwin's theory? The answer is simple, because it contradicts with the Bible, at least for four reasons. First, it denies the role of God as the creator of the universe. Second, it contradicts the event of creation as mentioned in Genesis chapter 1 and 2. Third, it projects human as a byproduct of a long stage of development. And fourth, it places human at the bottom of creation. So I list here at least 10 objections to Darwin theory. I'm going them one by one in detail. The first and the longest is scientific reason. Second is genetic reason. Third is unique feature for every creature. Fourth, profound details for creature. Fifth, complexity of human organ system. Sixth, distinguished variation between human. Seven, amazing human achievement. Eight, personality and characteristic of humans as feeling, emotion, and conscience. Nine, medical evidence, and 10, historical evidence. We'll start by the first one, a scientific reason. And this will include 5 points. The first one is the origin of life. The second is Cambrian explosion. The third is new unknown simple form of life. Four, limited experimentation. Five, diversity and complexity of humans. Let's start by the origin of life. Nowadays, we have more understanding than Darwin and the scientists at his time. So now we understand that all living cells have enormous amount of information. And this information starts as genetic code at the level of DNA and RNA. Later will be translated into protein, and these various proteins will perform different functions like growth, movement, cognition, and so on. So the assumption that random mutation can create such a complex and dense genetic material is nil, zero. Why? Because random mutation basically distort the genetic code and disrupt the protein synthesis process and shutting down the entire process. So it turned out actually what the people used to call genetic mutation, they don't understand exactly what they're talking about. Genetic mutation distort the natural protein process. It stopped the process and may result into errors. And these errors will result in disease and maybe tumors. For reason of simplification, I'm showing here on the left side the famous cartoon of the normal DNA compared with the mutated DNA when you have break off of the basics of the DNA helix arrangement. There are at least 6,000 diseases with known genetic disorders. I list here some of them, like cystic fibrosis connected with chromosome 7q, Down syndrome, chromosome 21, hemophilia, chromosome X, Klinefelter syndrome, chromosome X, neurofibromatosis, 17q22, sickle cell disease, 11p, Tay-Sachs disease, 15, and the list goes on and on. Not only genetic mutation can result in disease, but also can lead to tumors. And based on the National Cancer Institute, it's estimated that between 5 to 10% of cancer are due to genetic mutation. And I'm showing you an example how it works. On the left side is a shape of a normal cell. On the right side, the cell undergo mutation, then a second mutation, maybe a third or a fourth, and finally came with the tumor cells. And these tumor cells rapidly grow, multiply, invade other organs, and spread throughout the body and destroy the body. So genetic mutation is a terrible thing. It never was a good thing. It's a terrible thing. It results in disease and maybe cancer. Here is some list of tumors are being confirmed to be associated with genetic mutation. For example, breast cancer with BRCA1 and 2, ovarian fallopian tube cancer with, again, BRCA1 and 2, pancreatic cancer, MLH1, MSH2, TP53, melanoma, colon cancer, gastric cancer, uterine cancer, medullary thyroid carcinoma with red proto-oncogene. So there are a long list of tumors and cancer are associated with known genetic mutation. So those who are talking about genetic mutation as a cause of development from one stage of creature to another are absolutely wrong. They really don't understand what genetic mutation is. The second scientific evidence is what's known as Cambrian explosion, and this took place around 540 million years ago. So what is it? What's the Cambrian explosion? It's a geological sudden appearance of many of the major groups of animal in the fossil record, which means there is no gradual change over time that completely defies Darwin theory, because Darwin was based on gradual change over thousands and many of years. Now, the fossil record indicates there is a sudden appearance of the major groups of animals, which means the major group animals appear on Earth suddenly, all of them suddenly. There is no transition, there is no gradual movement from one stage to another. The majority appeared suddenly. I'm listing some of the picture of those that will be discovered, and this actually from the Chinese Academy of Science. Interestingly, that Darwin himself recognized this Cambrian explosion, and he couldn't find the right answer for it. He just tried to blame it on the imperfection of the fossil record, which means we couldn't find all the fossil record, so I'm let it go. He didn't have a right answer for it. A more evident discovery of new fossils. A Chinese paleontologist discovered a trove of well-preserved fossils in China from 518 million years, representing more than 50 previously undescribed animal species, like jellyfish, arthropod, and algae. And this completely defies Darwin theory that some species are become extinct and don't exist anymore. The next in scientific evidence is Darwin has a very limited experimentation. As I showed you before in the previous lecture, Darwin made a trip to South America, Galapagos Island, Australia, stopped by the tip of Africa, back to South America, and back to England. So he only have studied all those, or the majority of animals that he have seen in this area, mostly South America and the Galapagos Island. He do a study on animals in Africa, or in Asia, or in North America, or any other countries. He just focus in the southern part of the world. So generally speaking, if you want to make a theory to apply it to all the creature in the world, you have to make sure all of them being traced down to their original simpler form of life. You cannot just examine some and apply it to the all. So these are mostly the animals and the birds that he did his research on: finch bird, mockingbird, some tortoise, sea lion, iguana, armadillo, and rhea. So he didn't have a chance to study a big sea creature like dolphin, shark, and whales. He didn't study the birds of prey like hawks, falcon, and eagles. He didn't study a wide range of aggressive reptiles like king cobra or American alligator. He didn't study animals of the cold weather like snow leopard, musk, walrus, polar bear, and so on. He didn't study animals of Asia like tiger, red panda, Asian elephant. He didn't study animal Africa like hippopotamus or lions. Basically, he had a very limited study in certain organisms, birds, and animals in certain area of the world. He make a conclusion and want to apply this conclusion to the entire creation on the world. Before he has done this, he should actually have reviewed all the creature and make sure they all comply with his theory. And the final in the scientific evidence is what the scientists discover now as the complexity of living organism, or what's known as irreducible complexity. So what does it mean? The living organisms are actually very complex. They need so many parts to work together in harmony to maintain the function and sustain life. So if one of the small components is missing or absent, the entire function will stop. Maybe the simple and easiest method they use is the mousetrap, which has like five components. If one of those five components is missing or dysfunctional, the host mouse trap will be useless. To make it simple, they studied the bacterium flagellum, which is this little tail in the bacteria, and this flagellum caused the bacteria to move in a fast way in different direction. It turned out that this flagellum had 30 protein, and you need the entire 30 protein to produce function and start the movement. So the scientists destroy couple protein and check, can the bacteria swim or float or move? It turned out they can't. With 29 protein, they can. With 28 protein, they can. With 27, they can. 25, they can. You have to have the 30 protein together, work in harmony. So that's completely defy the theory of gradual movement. In Darwin theory, gradually change can still maintain life. Here we have obvious evidence from bacteria that gradual change stops the life because you need 30 different protein working at the same time to produce life. Gradual change, gradual deletion of this protein will stop the life of the bacteria. The other objection to Darwin theory, we're going to talk about genetic reason. So Darwin, at the beginning, he has some opposition from scientists in his time. Later on, because of the Industrial Revolution, it was picked up and some scientists start to support it. However, it fades away. Until the 20th century, some of the atheist scientists try to bring the story back to life. So study the similarity between the DNA, between human and the monkeys. And they try to figure out a cause or excuse to revive Darwin's theory again. So they discover 98.7% similarity between the human DNA and the monkey DNA. 98.7% is really a significant similarity. But again, to jump to conclusion and assume that Darwin was right and they can prove it by DNA. However, later on, a prudent and wise scientist said, okay, let's cool down and try to make the same study with other creatures and see if any similarities or only monkeys have similarities with humans. And this is the result, what they found. Humans share DNA with other creatures. For example, 97.5 with mice, 97.5, very close to the comparison with the monkeys. 90% with cat, 84% with dog, 80% with cow, 60% with chicken, 50% with banana, 15% with plant. More than this, they figure out there is almost 99% share with lats. And turn out the most similar and close to us is actually the dolphin. Some scientists made this statement. We have found that dolphin genome and the human genome are basically the same. So the closest animal to us is not the monkey, as Darwin postulated, but it is the dolphin, and we can prove it by DNA. So what that mean to us? I make the analogy here with the flour. From a flour, you can make Italian bread. You can make chocolate chip cookie. You can make bagels and muffin. You can make pizza. You can make pasta. So can you assume that the pizza was originally a bagel and the bagel was originally a muffin or a cookie and the cookie was originally a bread? No. Every one of them is a separate entity by itself. They all have the flour as a component, but each one is separate entity. So the secret here is not in the component, it's not in the flour, it is in the baker. The baker is the one who makes from the flour all these products. The baker in our story is God, and the flour is the DNA. So God out of the DNA make all kind of creature, make human, make birds, make animal, make plants. It is God, the baker. The problem of Darwin that he took God out of the equation. He only focused on the evidence. And he didn't actually do a thorough study. If you do a thorough study, at his time, maybe he didn't have the enough tool or research method, but now we can understand and figure out exactly what was wrong with Darwin theory. It is not the flour, it is the baker who makes the flour and shapes the flour. A third objection that each creature has unique feature that fit him to survive in his own environment. So the bird, for example, they have wings. The fish, they have fins. The human, they have feet. Never see human with wings or fish with feet. They don't need it. Everyone get what exactly he need to survive in his own particular environment. And that tells us there is God, God the creator, who put every creature in its own environment and give each one what they need to survive in this own environment. You take this creature out of the environment, they will die. You put man under the water for a few days, will die. You put fish on the ground for a few days, they die. Why? Not created to live in the earth. Let's take another example, lions and deers. Lions known to have strong teeth and strong muscle, they can devour deers. But deer, on the other hand, they are created with fast legs, so they can escape lions. If you look at the reproduction rate of the deers, it's much higher than the lions. So for every couple of deer that are being devoured by lion, there are many more are born, so they keep the balance in the nature. Look at the trees, for example. The trees act as a big recycle of the air of the world. The trees take the carbon dioxide and emit oxygen to regenerate the air. Can anybody claim that the trees was originally a bird or later on will transform into an animal? No. Every creature stands by its own self. It has what needs to survive and it serves a purpose or a role for the entire creature. The second objection is the profound detail of creature. All the creature have its own details, the found details, which mean God doesn't just print a copy machine, one mirror image for another. Even the fish that swim in the ocean that nobody look at, God make artists design them. Look at the lines, look at the color, even look at the shape. If you take a couple leaves from any tree, you'll never find two are the same. Try that. I did that in my own backyard. Pick up a couple leaves from some of the branches and figure out they are different. They might be different in the shape, different in the number of the branches, different in the number of the serration, different in the lines. There are differences. Who cares about the trees or the leaves? But God who created them, care about them. He have his special imprint in each one of them. The next objection to Darwin's theory is the complexity of human organ systems. I'm going to use three examples. First, we're going to start with the heart. So the heart at all time receiving blood and giving out blood, all the time. When the atria contract, the ventricle relax. When the ventricle contract, the atria relax. And there is a well-defined set of valves that open and close in a timely fashion. Who makes this amazing design for the heart to keep working? God. You cannot say, oh, by random chance. You cannot say, oh, just transformation from monkey to apes. No, it's God. Intelligent designer that designed the whole entire universe. Let's look at the kidneys. The kidney is basically doing an amazing job. It takes scientists years and years to understand how the kidneys function, how they absorb sodium and bicarb, how they create some secretions, how they make the balance of PTH, how they can control acidosis versus alkalosis of the body. It's amazing function. Look at the brain. The brain by the gross or naked eye looks the same. Under the microscope, the cell looks the same. However, there are certain areas of the brain are in charge of the recognition of intelligence, of emotion, and other areas in charge of the movement, other areas in charge of the hearing, other areas in charge of the vision. And when you know exactly why each area, although they look the same grossly and by microscopically, they have different functions. It's because God, the artist, who designed everyone separately. And that takes the next point, which is the distinguished variation between humans. Not all humans are similar or are identical. Even identical twins, the monozygotic twins are not identical. There are separation, there are differences between them. And God made to everyone its own ID. And you can check your fingerprint. No matter what, you cannot be similar to anyone else. And the retinal imprint also is another ID. And now science talk about voice recognition imprint. Everyone of us has a different level of voice that can be recognized by. So God not just putting human in the world, he make distinction for every one of us. Everyone else is known to him. Everyone else has its own criteria. Everyone else is loved by God. God know everyone from us. The other objection is the amazing human achievement. It's only the human race who make achievement. You never hear about any achievement by monkeys, or by birds, or by snake, or by dolphin, any other creatures. Only humans, only one who make creature, building skyscraper, tall high up, designing submarine that dive underwater, airplane that fly in the air, or huge tank that go on the surface of the earth. We did everything. And why is that? Because God gave us a special talent. God gave us special authority. We are on the crown of the earth and the crown of the creature. We are the only race that can generate and that can achieve, that can invent. No other invention came from animals or birds or plants or anything else. Only us, because we are distinguished and God recognizes us. He made us in his in image and likeness. The other objection is personality characters. We are not just robot or guinea pig. We have feeling, we have emotion, we have conscience. And that makes a distinction from one to another. And not only that, but we also have variation in a daily basis. Some days we are happy, some days we are sad, some days we are excited, some days we are depressed. So I mean, we have a wide range of emotion and feeling. Next, I'm going to talk about medical evidence. So Darwin basically did a study in a few birds and animals and make a theory, and he tried to apply this theory to the entire. So he tests a partial and he will make this apply to the whole. So in medicine, this turned out to be wrong. Successful medication, for example, who been used in some patients unsuccessful, cannot be used on all the patients. Some patients have resistance, some patients don't respond, and that's why all have what known as a second line or a third line of treatment. So it's not like one medicine fit all, no. I'm gonna talk about cervical cancer, which is known to be one of the devastating cancer in the last centuries. However, now it's been under control. So when they study the cervical cancer, how it progresses, it has something in a gradual progress. Start with few dysplastic cell at the base of the cervix, then these cells start to grow and grow until they occupy the entire thickness and start to invade through the basement membrane and becoming invasive tumor. So a gradual process, a very appealing idea to scientists. So you try to apply it to other organs with similar structure, like bladder, like lung, like other cavity. It didn't work. Why? Every organ has its own way of development and of cancer and tumors. So that exactly reminds me was what Darwin. Darwin said gradual development over years for certain creature. And he tried to apply it to the entire creature, including human. Absolutely wrong. And the last point I'm going to make is the historical events. And here I'm going to read from chapter 3 in the book of Genesis. So the Lord God said to the serpent, because you have done this, you have cursed more than all the cattle and more than every beast of the field, on your belly you shall go, and you shall eat dust all the days of your life. On your belly you shall go. From the time of Adam and Eve till today, all the serpents that we have seen and we have known and recognized go in their belly. We never see a snake go on its feet, or a snake that have wings, or a snake that have arms. No, they all go in their belly. Why? Because God's punishment and God's word is permanent. No one can change it. No one can disobey it. God's word is true, accurate, and permanent. Again, in Genesis chapter 3, to the woman he said, I will greatly multiply your sorrow and your conception. In pain you shall bring forth children. Your desire shall be for your husband, and he shall rule over you. In pain you shall bring forth children. Well-known fact. All moms from the time of Adam and Eve till today, they suffer during labor. They suffer. No one can escape the suffering. No one can escape the pain. Even those who try to avoid it by going to cesarean section, they suffer a lot after surgery from the healing of the tissues. And their pain may be less for a couple months. And every time they are pregnant, they have to deliver by cesarean section and they have more and more pain for longer duration. Why? God punishment. God word. True, accurate, and permanent. No one can change it. And let's look at this. And he shall rule over you. For until today, we still experience inequality between men and women. Till today, females are complaining inequality of payment, of wages, of possession. A lot of things. Why? Was part of God's punishment to Eve. To Adam. He said, curse is the ground for your sake. In toil you shall eat of it. All the days of your life, both thorns and thistle, it shall bring forth for you. And you shall eat the herb of the field. In the sweat of your face you shall eat bread, till you return to the ground, for out of it you were taken, for dust you are, and to dust you shall turn. Genesis 3, verse 20. In the sweat of your face you shall eat bread, which when you have to work hard, you have to sweat to eat your bread. A well-known fact to all of us as human, no one of us have an easy job. No one. Everyone has a supervisor. A supervisor has a higher supervisor. Then you have a manager, and you have a regional manager, and you have a president, and you have a CEO, and you have the president, have the Congress and the senator question him. Everyone have someone who review his work, criticize him, and blame him for errors. No one has an easy job from the time of Adam till today. Not only that, but he say, for dust you are, and to dust you shall return. A well-known fact, no one can argue about it, that everyone, when you die, you turn out into dust. Why? God's word is permanent, is eternal. No one can change it. I'm going to go in a few examples about God's vows, or God's promises, or God's punishment that came true ahead of time. So to Noah, God declared that he will destroy man and beast and birds by flood. And it happened. Noah took almost 100 years to build the ark, maybe a little bit more. However, he had faith in God, and he stayed for 100 years. He never gave up, never lost hope, never lost faith. And it turned out it's true. It takes time, but it happened and destroyed everything that's lived. And now we have a scientific proof of the ark and where it ended up. God declared to Father Abraham that his descendant will be slave in a foreign country for 400 years. Then they will come out from this country with a mighty hand and will come back to the same land that he's staying there, and they will take possession of it. And it happened that Joseph came to Egypt with all the family of Israel. They lived for 400 years under torture. God sent Moses, and Moses brought them out by mighty hand and went back to the promised land and took possession of it. God declared to Moses he will strike Egypt 10 times with 10 plagues, and it happened. God declared to his people, if they don't stop worshiping idols and go back to the temple, offer the sacrifice, he will destroy them and will take them to Babel as a slave. And that was mentioned 2 times, one in Isaiah and one in Jeremiah. So in Isaiah 39, we read, the days come that all in your house and that which your father have laid up in store until this day shall be carried to Babylon. Nothing shall be left, said the Lord. Everything will be taken to Babylon, which means everybody will be taken captive to Babylon. Nobody will be left. In Jeremiah 20, God said, and they shall fall by the sword of their enemies, and your eyes shall behold it. And I will give all Judah into the hand of the king of Babylon, and he shall carry them captive to Babylon and shall slay them with the sword. Jeremiah 20, verse 4. Not only that, but God declared them after 70 years, he will return them back to their own land. In Daniel 9, 24, we read, 70 weeks are determined for your people and for your holy city to finish transgression, to make an end of sin, to make reconciliation of iniquity, to bring in everlasting righteousness, to seal up vision and prophecy, and to anoint the most holy. And the return came back in 3 waves. Zerubbabel, then Ezra, then Nehemiah. So if every word God said in the Bible turned out to be true, if every promise God made turned out to be true, if every punishment God said he will do turned out to be true, then why we shouldn't trust God? Why we doubt God? If he said, I am the creator, why we doubt him? He said, I am created the heaven and earth, why we doubt him? If he said, I make man my own image and likes, why we doubt him? If everything in the Bible God said turned out to be true, we should trust him more. We should believe in him more. We shouldn't doubt him. Now I'll leave this question to the researcher. Those who are interested in investigating Darwin theory from a neutral and impartial view, I want them to answer this question in their own. If apes developed into human, then why only the apes underwent development or evolution? Why no other animals like rabbit or cat or dog, any other animal? Why only apes? If apes were developed into human, why aren't they extinct? part of Darwin theory that those who are being developed into other animals will survive. Those who didn't will go extinct. Why the rest of the monkeys didn't extinct? Why until today we have monkeys and we have apes, have chimpanzees? Third, why did the apes evolution stop and no more evolution? Why you go to the zoo is still the same monkey in the same cage? Why this monkey in the zoo never changed to human? Fourth, why did evolution stop at the human level? Why human didn't develop? If the development or revolution coming in the nature of the earth and the creation of the earth, why all this evolution stop at human level? Why human didn't develop into maybe a lion or into an eagle or into angels? Why not? Five, why there are people and animals who suffer from famine and starvation and did not change? So the basic idea of Darwin that there is limited resources. And because of this limited resource, there is a competition between living organisms. The nature will help certain organisms to eat, survive, and the other extinct. Now I give you an example from famine in Africa and Asia. Terrible disaster that happened to these people. Those who died, died. Those who lived, lived. But there is no transformation. We have not witnessed transformation of any animal to another form of animal, or any human to another form of humans. Everyone kept on the same at the end. So what we left up with? Charles Darwin with an enthusiastic, agonist, young British aristocrat with no solid background biology. He made an exciting trip to South America, collected some bird and animal sample, finally made a theory that will change the teaching of science for many centuries. However, no definite scientific, geological, religious, historical, and medical evidence to support his theory. No definite evidence. On the contrary, we have the evidence to prove him wrong, and I list 10 of them. However, it came in the wrong time. This time was the elite British society welcomed his theory because it justified their dominance over the public using the term survival of the fittest. What I want everyone to read now is read the Bible. Pay attention to what God said to Hosea, chapter 4. My people are destroyed for the lack of knowledge. My people are destroyed for the lack of knowledge. Lack of knowledge can destroy you. You have to know your Bible. You have to know what's in the Bible. So you don't be carried by any wave of teaching. You know your Bible. You know your material. You don't be fooled by any scientist or who they call themselves scientists. Let's go back to chapter 1 and chapter 2 in the Bible. You'll find the answer to Darwin's theory. Life has a steady system from the beginning. When God created life, he made a system and no one can violate, change, or defy the system. Let's read Genesis 1, verse 11 to 12. And God said, let the earth bring forth grass, the herb yielding seed, and the fruit tree yielding fruit after its kind, whose seed is in itself upon the earth. And it was so. And the earth brought forth grass and herb yielding seed after its kind, and the tree yielding fruit, whose seed was in itself after its kind. Which means, God, when he planted, or God, when he ordered the tree to grow, he put seed in this fruit that will be planted and bring the same type of fruit. You print orange, you're getting orange. You print apple, you're getting apple. It had never happened at all. Nobody had witnessed that an orange tree bring forth apple, or an apple tree bring forth orange. Orange is orange, apple is apple. Why? Because God put the system, its inherent system, within the tree itself. The seed will bring forth the same type of the fruit. Chapter 2. God clearly make a declaration there are three separate and different type of creature he will do. First, in Genesis 1, chapter 20. And God said, let the water bring forth abundantly the living creature, and the birds fly above the earth, across the face of the firmament of heaven. So now he's talking about the birds. In 24, and God said, let the earth bring forth the living creature after his kind, cattle, creeping thing, and beasts of the earth after his kind. And it was so, which means the earth followed God's order. The earth obeyed God's order and did so. Third, and the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground, and breathed into his nostril the breath of life, and man became a living soul. three separate different type of creature. No overlap, no cross between them, no bridge between them. Three separate different type of creature. Why somebody will come and challenge us? Every word that God spoke came out true. Why should I doubt him in the first thing that he said? Now let's make a quick comparison between the Bible and Darwin. In the Bible, God is the creator. In Darwin, creation developed on its own with the help of nature and mutation, which basically take God out of the creation. In the Bible, God created man his image and likeness. While in Darwin, humans are actually descended from apes. So the Bible tells you that God make you in his own image. Darwin tells you, no, you are shaped after the monkeys. In the Bible, humans are the heart of God. In Darwin, no relationship between human and God. Complete separation if you ever believe that there is God to start with. In the Bible, man is the crown and the dominant of all creature. While in Darwin, man is at the bottom of the creation. So now we understand the difference between the Bible and Darwin. So somebody should tell me why you should believe in Darwin theory. Why you should teach Darwin theory? I would like to make a call for a wise and impartial review of Darwin theory based on all the evidence submitted in my lecture. I would like to thank you for the attendance. This was a long and comprehensive review of Darwin theory. I'll see you next week in another lecture in Genesis chapter 3 about fall of Adam and Eve into sin and God's punishment to them and how sin started and spread through generation. Thank you for attendance and glory be to God forever. Amen.